So when did you get involved in the St. Croix Valley Foundation?
6 years ago was my first board meeting, and never look back. It's been a great opportunity to serve.
What it is about it, the serving on this board, that's been rewarding to you?
The rewards have been many. To be able to do good and help people and listen, and I think from my perspective, learn. There's been so much learning from our affiliates up and down the River Valley, all 10, and being a quiet partner to help them grow, to learning from the staff and Jane's leadership, to learning from the existing board members, prior board members, friendships developed with these individuals, because everybody is rowing in the same direction, and can't tell you how much fun, but at the end of the day, it's just a lot of good that's been done for the River Valley and indeed around the world.
Another thing about when I ask you a question, I'm not going to be in the interview, so if you were to say yes or no, it wouldn't be a very interesting response. So try to build my question into sometimes, you know. What about the impulse to get involved in this sort of thing? Where did that come from in you?
So the impulse to get involved with the foundation initially was a friend, Steve Wilcox, said, hey, you have to know more about this organization. And met Jane Stevenson, met Dave Wettergren, met some other individuals that have become good friends, and the fact that the mission was so appealing, just to help others here in the valley, could be items in terms of affordable housing, making sure there's warm clothing for youngsters, especially in the wintertime, making sure, you know, arts, theater, music is advocated here in the River Valley, just all sorts of good people rowing in the same direction for a good cause. That's really what got me excited back 6 years ago when I was first asked.
I know you weren't here at the beginning, but as I understand it, at the beginning there was it was really kind of a Stillwater-based original origins of this, but they were wise enough to want to make it a St. Croix Valley. So they put their headquarters in Wisconsin, and they recruited members for their board from all over the place. Do you have any thoughts on the, looking back now, all these years, on the wisdom of that strategy?
The wisdom of going across the river and trying to pull cities together, communities together, states together, was really a humbling act. And you know, you go back and, you know, as a lawyer, we talked about the framers of the Constitution. You know, you have the framers of St. Croix Valley Foundation, these founders, and you don't want to let them down. And they gave us such a great start with being inclusive and trying to avoid the pettiness that sometimes was part of the history of Stillwater versus Hudson, or name your community up and down the watershed, but they got past that pretty quickly. And so from our perspective here, as we celebrate the founder's vision, as a board, we certainly don't want to let them down and want to continue growing off of their original seeds of ideas so many years ago.
When you first got on the board, did you have a sense of some areas that you thought needed addressing or focus of the foundation, or did you, when you got on the board, develop some areas that became of interest to you?
In terms of areas of focus, I think with any nonprofit, you have this dichotomy of mission, you know, what you stand for, what you do day in and day out, supporting current and future donors. But that mission is exciting, and everybody wants to help and be part of that opportunity to do good in the valley. But you have to also juxtapose that to margin and making sure that, I'm sure in the early days with the founders, it was just keeping the lights turned on. And you know, we still have those conversations today. We have a great staff. We're never going to be full staffed, but we've got one of the best teams I've ever seen running this nonprofit organization. And there'll be growth opportunities to expand that staff. There'll be opportunities to touch our donors and potential donors in the future differently than we have in the past. But this ability to do things the right way and ensure that we're good stewards of almost $50 million of assets under management, I mean, it's an incredible responsibility. But comparing the mission, which people kind of cling to and are very excited by, but also, hey, we have to run this almost like a for-profit some days just to make sure that we have the best possible staff and make sure that we're aligned with our affiliates up and down the river valley. And so those two ideas permeate my thoughts as to the foundation today and going forward. And I'm sure other people serving on the board have had similar ideas going back.
Yeah, John Baird made a comment that I thought was interesting that kind of a little bit dovetails what you said about the management of it. He was talking about how easy it is to spend the money, but the foundation needs to keep their eye on taking money in. How have they been doing on that?
Yeah, a wise man like John Baird or Bradshaw or any of these founders, the thrill of service and especially serving on this board is those granting stories, those giving back stories, and then that pure goodness of just helping someone else that's in need. I think from my standpoint, right now, something that we want to work harder on is being able to fulfill more of our grant requests. Andy Cass does a great job running our grants area, but I know he, like everyone else on the board, would like us to be able to fulfill 100% of the grant requests here in the valley. And so to march as quickly but as diligently and in a disciplined fashion towards that, that's a paramount issue for the board as we move forward.
As you now have had 6 years of experience on the board, is there a particular area of interest or need that you're focusing on?
In terms of needs for the foundation moving forward, our affiliate partners, now at 10 up and down the river valley, we've learned so much from them. And everybody's at a different stage of maturity. Some are the early stages, some are very mature and have great programming. And I think how best to serve each of them, they're like different pieces of the puzzle, and they're different shapes, and so it's one thing to run a foundation, it's another thing to help shepherd in just the right.
When this was first conceived, there was some thought about becoming part of an existing foundation in the Twin Cities, but they set up a foundation out here to better need. Are you familiar with that, the thinking that went into that, or was that before your time?
Well, it was before my time, but I know a little bit about the story.
Why don't you talk to me about that?
Well, I think my understanding, and we had a great event back in April, kind of just celebrating the founders' original idea, to be inclusive but to be unique and really serve the St. Croix River Valley. And the courage that it took to not just be part of a larger community foundation. We've got several here in the Twin Cities, and they're all good and do good work, but just to have a separate and distinct brand, today you pick up any magazine on advertising or marketing, they talk about the importance of your brand and carrying that forward. Our founders, they knew that back 20 years ago and understood to grow something for the valley, in the valley, on behalf of those in need in the valley, we needed our own organization. And so happy looking back that they had that courage to do that.
Do you think the focus of the foundation's changed in the last 25 years?
In terms of the focus of the foundation over these many years changing, I think I would answer it in two ways. First, the original founders just wanted, from talking to several of them personally, they just wanted to do good. They just wanted an organization that would be receptive to ideas of giving back and being good stewards here in the River Valley. So I don't think that's changed at all in terms of that original mission. Every day there's opportunities to convene, and that responsibility to make people aware of different topics, that probably has changed over the years. I think in my early years with the foundation, I didn't realize that convening was an important part of being a community foundation and an important responsibility. And this last fall, we've learned so much leadership from Angie Pilgrim on the Remember Project, making Alzheimer's and dementia, making people more aware and marching towards dementia-friendly cities here in the watershed has been unbelievably popular and has helped our brand grow. And I'm not sure if that would have been part of the original thought process of the founders, but I think in retrospect, it's good that we have new ideas and try things as long as it fits that original mission of doing good.
A lot, when you're facing a problem, one of the smartest things you can do is get the right people around the table. Has the St. Croix Valley Foundation done that?
The right people have been around the table at the St. Croix Valley Foundation from the founders and the discussions I've had with those founders at the event we had last April, to the current board, and the learnings that I've had, and I think other board members would echo past and present, how pure the goodness is in terms of no one wants a pat on the back, no one needs their name in the paper. It's just all about helping people with affordable housing or nutrition, a good meal. There's just so many opportunities to serve because it's not perfect here in the valley, and because there are so many needs, it's heartening to see so many good people just rallying around, just doing good works.
Todd, when I was talking to some of the original founders, they were throwing all kinds of loose change into the fund just to get it started, and now 25 years later, it's actually gone up. I think the corpus has gone up since I started doing these interviews. So have you been surprised in your time in the board at the growth and the success of the foundation?
I really haven't been surprised by the growth and the success is based on a number of measures. The number of people involved, over 100 people, when you factor in all the affiliate boards, our staff, our current board size, and we want those numbers to grow. You throw in our donor base and prospective donors. I mean, those numbers of people that know about us and use us are going to grow exponentially over the next 5 to 10 years, and I'm excited about that. Numerically, in terms of assets under management, we're approaching $50 million, and the next 5 to 10 years we'll be at $100 million, and that's exciting. We are needing to do harder work is the grant requests are coming in fast and furious, and we need to do a better job satisfying those because there are so many needs here in the watershed.
I've already kind of touched on this question, but I want to come at it from a different angle. Just the importance of why the focus on the St. Croix Valley? Are there some unique problems or opportunities here that made it a particularly good focus?
The focus for our home here in the five counties that we serve, the watershed of the St. Croix River Valley, it's just a home. I think, Jane would have the actual data, but probably a large, large majority of gifts are localized and people want to help here in their communities, from Prescott to the south, up to Grantsburg to the north, and even further north in the watershed. And that's great, but there also are the abilities to give on a national basis or an international basis through the foundation as well. And so in terms of being an a la carte opportunity for our donors to choose where and when and how, we offer all sorts of options, but the data thus far, yeah, this is our home, this is where people want to focus their philanthropy, but to have the ability to help in other parts of the world certainly is of interest to many donors as well.
I bet that means that you've tapped into money, and there is wealth in this region that no one else would have gotten to because they wouldn't have had the connections.
I think having our home here in the valley, having this, I'll call them an army of advocates, these affiliate representing communities up and down the watershed, has certainly increased our brand awareness. We got more work to do, connecting with financial advisors and CPAs and the attorney corps out there and make sure they understand what our capabilities are. So there's a lot more work to do, but proud of the fact that with staff hard work and hard work from all the affiliates in our current and predecessor boards, that there's a lot of people that understand the brand of the St. Croix Valley Foundation, but we know we're just getting started.
I would like to ask you two questions I asked you already because I didn't have the level proper on the first two questions. So if you don't mind, I want to ask you again to tell me about what was your impulse to get involved in this and why was it important for you to do that?
My impulse to get started with the St. Croix Valley Foundation, first, it's a privilege to serve. I've had the privilege of serving on some other nonprofits. My wife, Chris, and I have been involved in helping to a certain extent. And when Steve Wilcox, my friend, said, hey, you got to learn more about the St. Croix Valley Foundation, got to meet David Wettergren, Gretchen Stein. My goodness, I've met so many good people, smart people, learned people. I've learned so much more than anyone has learned from me in this experience, and it just impressed me that there's so many people wanting to do good, just pure good, and not expecting any rewards for it, but just helping people, because every one of us goes through times that are difficult, and so to be able to help out. And whether it's a winter coat or whether it's affordable housing or whether it's a meal, these are important things in the valley and improve our quality of life, not only for today but for generations to come. So I've been the one that's learned an immense amount from my friends on the board and those on the affiliate boards as well as our staff.
Todd, the second question that I wanted to ask again was, you said some nice things about the staff. So what role does the staff play in the success of the foundation?
The staff plays a significant role, and I would just, from Stacy Rivard, Sally Herman, Margie Miller, Angie Pilgrim, Jane Stevenson leading the staff, I hope I've not forgotten anybody, but they are loyal to the donors, they're loyal to each other, they're loyal to the affiliates, and they are a hardworking crew that understand the responsibilities of a foundation, and that is a responsibility to each donor. Be great stewards for those donors, as well as the convening function, the Remember Project, that has been a huge success, and there have been several other examples of convening that have gone very well. But the staff puts in innumerable hours, and some are compensated and some are not, quite frankly, because they do all go the extra mile. And I hope that's appreciated by current board. We certainly thank them, but probably not enough. And certainly, hopefully, recognized by the affiliate boards and our donor base as well.
My last question is, do you have a favorite project that captures your imagination? Or one that you're most proud of for your involvement?
That's a really good one, John.
Take your time. Yeah. The electrons are cheap.
Yeah, thanks.
Or what do you think is the most important thing they're doing? Because you talked about the knees.
I think the project... I think what I'm most interested in and something that we continue to work on, and I could talk about the Remember Project and how that's impacted people and other programs that are equally as important, but I go back to the mission of the organization and ensuring the brand is kept, I'm gonna do this again, John.
Electrons are cheap.
Yeah, you got me on this one. There's about 15 things I want to say, but I think I'm gonna do it this way.
All right.
Yeah, from a project standpoint, there's so many that that I'm proud of having, you know, a small role. You know, the heavy lifting is staff and the affiliate boards and the current board of the St. Croix Valley Foundation. I could single out the dementia, Alzheimer's, the Remember Project. That's been unbelievably satisfying because all of us have been touched in one way or another by dementia. But I'm going to answer it this way. I think from a board standpoint, just ensuring that the mission is carried out to our best ability, make sure that that brand of the St. Croix Valley Foundation continues to burn brightly in the most positive ways to honor the founders. And as important as that mission and our brand and being good stewards of these gifts, present and future, is this concept of mission and ensuring that there's viability. Like any for-profit business, we got to make sure we can continue to turn the lights on, the staff is reasonably paid for excellent work and have the best possible staff. And so that dual role of mission, margin in equal measure, I think is very, very important and certainly has served the foundation well. Going back so many years, and hopefully that formula will serve us well going forth for the next 25 years.
Actually, my imagination has carried me away, and I have one more question. You've been on the board for 6 years, so you weren't there in 2008 when everything collapsed, but you've been around, I think, to see how well managed this foundation must have been to get through that great recession in as good a shape as it did. Do you have any comments about that?
I wasn't around in 2008 serving on the board. Let me say that differently. Mm-hmm. Yeah, my time with the St. Croix Valley Foundation was after the Great Recession, which I remember well. In this business, helping people with their financial lives, that was a nightmare. And I know starting soon after that, it was a nightmare for the foundation, only in that there was lots of discussion about how are we going to keep the lights on, are we going to have to cut staff, and leadership on the board, David Wettergren, I think, was in charge when I first started, and how he led the organization with help from other board members was great learning for me at a very, very difficult time. And having survived that extremely well, looking back at the history of the foundation, gives us great courage going forward. If we can survive a cycle, a downturn like that, and if we keep our eye on margin and mission, I'm very, very bullish on how well this foundation is going to do looking ahead the next 20 to 25 years.
Very good. Tom, is there any question I didn't ask that you think I should have?
Wow, you asked about 10 more than I thought you were going to ask. No, you did an excellent job, John.
Okay.
Yeah, well done.
Well, thanks.
Yeah, this is going. All right, so I just want to start up by saying who you are and describe briefly your involvement in the St. Croix Valley Foundation.
Sure. Well, my name is Peter Kelly. I'm the executive director of a nonprofit organization in West Central Wisconsin called WestCap, and our mission has been to alleviate poverty. We've been around for 50 years this year, and I came here as executive director from the Wilder Foundation actually 21 years ago. So I was on the in this job when I was actually recruited to the board of the St. Croix Valley Community Foundation at that time by John Baird, who I'd worked with his son at Wilder Forest in a previous job, so he briefly knew me. And frankly, his I always enjoyed his line when he called me up to see if I was interested in this. And you know, he knows very well that my background is you know, poor farmers and rural Lutheran ministers, so I don't come out of a, you know, wealthy family background or anything. And he said he thought it'd be a good idea to have somebody on the board who was looking through the other end of the telescope. I never really understood that, but I always appreciated it. I thought it was great, and was happy to serve, and got in. Then I really wasn't part of the founding group, but I was sort of in the first wave once they got established and organized. I was very involved in the recruitment and ultimately the hiring of Ron Cruz, the first director of the foundation. He's also a person that I had known from my work with Wilder, and was able to contact him and have some, you know, participation in that. And then basically as we created this foundation and spent time working out that vision and mission, I just became a complete believer that this is an excellent thing to happen in here. You know, particularly on the Wisconsin side of the river, we're in a area that we would call foundation poor. A lot of the big foundations, as I like to think of it, you know, stand with their back to Wisconsin looking west, you know, with their great vision, and I understand all that. But this particular part of Wisconsin is kind of out of the range of the larger metropolitan foundations in Wisconsin that are tend to be in the southeast, Milwaukee, Madison, that area. And you know, so the kind of resources and philanthropy that can be very useful for nonprofit work in this part of the world has always been a struggle. There have been some really important local players, the Anderson Foundation family, the Otto Bremer Foundation has been very critical, but it's been hard beyond that to attract, you know, support from big foundations. Besides that, I've always had a strong positive feeling about sort of keeping things local. That this idea that we care for either poor people or the environment or something by, you know, sending money to Washington or, you know, having those sort of having other organizations come in and do that work for us in a sense, has struck me as being a little less than authentic. And the kinds of community that I grew up knowing, I spent my summers on rural farms here in Wisconsin, which is why I came back here to raise my family. We had a great sense of community here. And you know, people looked out after each other, and they cared about the entire community and not just their own little pieces of it and whatnot. And I believe that that is, you know, the best way for areas to meet their needs. If that's lacking, we certainly need other programs, you know, don't get me wrong, but when things are working the best, I think that's the way it's you know, it's carried out. So at the very least, I was interested in encouraging that kind of sort of home-based regional philanthropy in the area.
To that point, this is I'm getting ahead of my questions, but I thought it was kind of smart of the people who founded this. There were a lot of people from Stillwater, but they didn't want it just to be a Stillwater Foundation.
Right.
So they put the office in Wisconsin and recruited people from both sides of the state. So talk about maybe the foresightedness of that approach.
Well, I think you're absolutely right. This was, I think, just the best way to structure this. In order to keep it, to make it really useful in this area, if it was seen just as a Stillwater community project or just, you know, a certain group of individuals and their own, you know, philanthropic interest or whatnot, I don't think it would have had anywhere near the reach or success that it has had. One of the ideas that, you know, we developed early on that has stuck with me and still, I think, speaks well to this whole notion is this concept of this area being a community of communities. You know, particularly in Wisconsin, we have all these small towns, but they're also kind of connected. You know, they're not isolated, and things really work the best around here if there is more interaction between these groups. So this vision of providing a place where, you know, you not only can provide services that help all those little communities and mid-sized communities with their own community foundations and support that sort of activity, but it also helps bring this area together as a region. And it's actually quite challenging because, particularly in the Wisconsin side, we sort of have this major division between, you know, the people that historically have lived here, which tend to be farmers and agriculturalists and small business. And then we have this huge influx of folks who are really oriented to the metropolitan area, come over here to live and build their homes and whatnot. And that sort of bifurcation of the population has, you know, certainly caused some tensions and created some challenges. And these activities that tend to bring some cohesion to the region, I think have been very helpful. And frankly, the success you see in the foundation, its ability to attract funding and get support and do meaningful work is a testimony to that strategy being really wise.
Yeah, John Baird says it's really easy to spend money, but raising money isn't so easy. But yet, the foundation's had an incredible record. Could you talk about that?
Well, that's exactly what I'm getting at. That, you know, people do what they want to do. And so the foundation has created an opportunity for people who want to be helpful in this area to see this as a way to do that. And, you know, if it wasn't appealing, it wouldn't have worked. So, yes, it's just been a successful strategy. It's really, in the early days, you know, when we were, you know, struggling to get to $500,000 endowment, you know, and knowing what it would take to actually be able to support a staff and all that kind of stuff, you know, it seemed like a pretty distant reality, you know, and the idea of raising $5 million or $10 million, you know, was in the early days, you know, that was the pipe dream, you know, and maybe if everything goes really great, we can do this. So they've now gone past $30 million and you know, still rising. To me, it's just a great success story.
What were the needs that people saw out here that required a locally based foundation?
Well, one of the things that this was during an era, for example, of welfare reform, and there was a lot of challenges to systems that had been supporting particularly low income populations and you know, other, you know, needs like that for a long time. And as that was becoming a reality, it became very clear that, you know, taking this population and making it possible, you know, for them to get to work, you know, required a whole lot of other supports and community engagement. There was also, as I recall, sort of a growing concern about our regional environment. You know, we'd kind of recently seen the St. Croix, you know, get the National Scenic River designation, and yet, you know, we watched the philanthropy you know, tending for, if you're an environmental group, you send your money off to the Sierra Club or off to the World Wildlife Federation and stuff, all of which is great. I mean, these organizations do great work. But we also, we're seeing the real need for an increased environmental awareness in this part of the country. And there was very little resource, you know, that was directed to, you know, these, this part of the country, you know, in the valley. So that's one of the things that, you know, cropped up. There's also, you know, a real interest in supporting the arts. And again, you know, the arts funding tends to go to the cities, or it tends to go to, you know, other places. And there is a tremendous reservoir of artistic talent and interest in this part of the world. And so finding ways to channel some money into those activities, whether it's, you know, theater or visual arts or, you know, craftsmanship and that kind of stuff. So these are just a few of the things that, that I recall, at least, as being seen as needs that were not being adequately met.
Well, clearly there's wealth in the valley, and so someone figured out how to tap into that.
Well, yeah, and that, there's another dimension that is also pretty widely known in the area of philanthropy, which is that these couple decades that we're in here, the baby boomers, you know, get ready to retire or retire, is going to be a period of tremendous transfer wealth. And, you know, frankly, the way I think the future is shaping up, this may be the apex of that, you know. So you want some mechanism, again, to be able to capture that and to put it to use in the area where it was developed and where, you know, rather than having it, you know, sent off to other parts of the world, and to be able to retain some of that here for the future of the region. You know, that's a good idea.
Has a focus, in other words, what the foundation does, the kind of activities it gets involved in, has it modified in the last 20 to 25 years?
Well, I'd have to confess that I'm not fully on top of all the foundation activities at this point. You know, I was left the board 9 years ago, and I currently serve on 7 boards, 3 of which are national, and a couple of them are extremely intensive. And frankly, just in terms of my own career development, I was very involved with the state for a while. I led the state's association for organizations like mine, and then was kicked up to the regional, and for the last 12 years I've been on the national board, and frankly a lot of my attention has gone into that work. So I keep an eye on it, and you know, our agency has a nice agency fund at the foundation, and you know, been able to participate in quite a lot of the foundation legacy activities and whatnot, but I'm not totally on top of the, you know, current programmatic work of the foundation.
So were you then involved in the Wisconsin version of the organization that Marcia Avner headed up in Minnesota, those, it's the Nonprofits, Association of Nonprofits?
Not so much. Oh, okay. But you may be familiar with the Minnesota Community Action mm-hmm. Association.
Oh, yeah. Caps.
So in Wisconsin, it's WISCAP, the Wisconsin Community Action Program Association. And I chaired that board for 5 years, and then, you know, so I was very engaged in that. And then, like I say, that group sends a board rep to the region, and the region sent me up to the national, and so that's where I've been for a while. But yeah, Arnie Anderson over there, I don't know if you know him, had been with the state now for the last probably 8 years, has directed the Minnesota CAP Association. I work with Arnie a lot. I actually have quite a lot of engagement across the river. We run a program that's been replicated by the Duluth Community Action Agencies, and I'm a good friend of Mike Thorstenson over at Three Rivers CAP. I don't know if you've run into Mike.
I know Mike. He's married to my cousin.
Well, there you go. Yeah. I was just at a big... He's on... There are two national organizations in the community action world, and I'm on the board of one, he's on the board of the other, and we just had a big summit in St. Louis a month ago, and I like Mike very much.
Yeah,
I think
too.
He's a great guy. So, so you know, and again, that's just kind of another example of the kinds of activities, you know, that kind of bring this, these areas together, and we can look at this watershed as a region. And frankly, particularly these days, you don't want these state borders to be such, you know, hard political boundaries. You know, they're very different in that way, and that really kind of divides us. And
yeah,
I'm much more interested in the things that connect us.
Well, that's good. Foundations, successful ones, have an ability to get the right people around the table. What's been your experience with the St. Croix Valley Foundation's ability to do that?
Well, I look back on my decade on the on that Community Foundation board as just a great experience. I have tremendous respect and admiration for the people that were recruited to that board. It was a great experience, you know, both personally and professionally, and frankly, a real encouragement, you know, to see the kind of commitment and dedication that, you know, people who frequently could do a lot of other things with their time and interest that, you know, put that into the community. We also, at least when I was on the board, did a number of kind of regional forums where we would bring representatives of nonprofits or other things together to talk about, you know, needs, issues. We had a big project around the St. Croix Valley watershed, you know, that took kind of a different approach to thinking about the area and brought some good folks together. So, and again, going back to the whole idea of this being a regional foundation as opposed to being the Stillwater Foundation or something, it really speaks to the wisdom of that approach, all of which predated me. They had that figured out before I showed up, but I was certainly happy to participate in when I was able to do so.
I'm going to ask you questions about challenges and opportunities. I guess I'll start out with a challenge. What would you see as the greatest challenge that the foundation will face in the next 20 years?
Well, one of the things that I've been doing for the last 10 years has been putting probably an inordinate amount of time and effort into what the future is going to be like for low-income populations in particular. And I head up an initiative on the national board of the Community Action Partnership called the New Reality Initiative, which looks at the impacts of environmental degradation, climate change, and that kind of thing, resource depletion, debt-based financing, and all that. And it really has convinced me that the whole society is entering some very troubling times. I sort of think of it as the age of limits. We finally began to hit them, and they're hard physical limits. They're not limits politically and limits of choice and that kind of thing. Some of the main factors that will dictate the future will be unavoidable. It'll be driven by physics and biology and chemistry. It's not going to be driven by opinion and belief and whatnot. We're not ready for that. We don't understand that. So we're beginning to see, you know, the fire you were talking about before we started filming here in Washington that I'm also paying close attention to, and the droughts in California, and, you know, some of the incredible storms, you know, we're seeing in Pakistan and India and China and out in the Pacific and whatnot. We're entering a different era, and this will have profound economic implications. Plus, frankly, the debt-based financing system that has worked pretty well for the country, once you go around the exponential curve, things get really challenging. So, you know, we find, you know, we're not that far ultimately from the kind of situation we're seeing in Europe and Greece and other places where, you know, the debt is unsustainable, but if you implement austerity, too dramatically, you know, you just actually get backward. And it's kind of, it's a dilemma. You know, there really isn't much of a solution to it. You have to go through it. So I think there's going to be major economic challenges and major demands for, you know, needs and services that, you know, governments are going to have a harder time meeting because of their financial problems. And I think, you know, we're just going to be entering a period of profound societal change and need. The good news in that, in a way, is that the future, however it shapes up, and I'm not going to make predictions about this, that, or anything, there's too many variables, but taken as a package, I'm convinced that the future is going to be much more local than we've seen in the last 20 years. You know, this big global economy and all those, you know, international connections and things, I think that's going to be diminishing, which means that the region, all the regions and localities are going to have to do a better job of meeting their own needs with their own resources, being more self-directed in terms of their economy and systems of looking after each other and whatnot. So the need for organizations like, you know, the St. Croix Valley Foundation will only increase. But the challenge is the resources are also going to be probably harder to raise, and, you know, the demands will be harder to meet. So it's going to be a time of, you know, serious engagement. I can't, you know, those are the, you know, the macro issues that I think are going to be confronting the foundation in very direct and real ways.
During your time on the board, what investment or series of investments are you most proud of?
Well, what I look, you know, back on and thought was most interesting, I'm not sure if it would be investment so much from a monetary sense, but the board really invested a lot of time into learning about and understanding the region as a region. You know, we used to, you know, move board meetings around to different communities and really made sure that we, as a group, got to understand the place. One of the great experiences, just in terms of both being enjoyable and interesting, but also informative, we went out on the Anderson Foundation motor launch, Glengarry or whatever the name is, but brought a geologist from the University of Minnesota. And so as we went up the valley, you know, he gave that deep background to what it is that formed this place when I turned out. And those efforts, I think, really kind of paid off, you know, so that the foundation knew what it was doing and knew the area that it was working in. And I was engaged with that, and I feel proud about that work.
Any parting observations to make about the foundation, or where do you see it going in the future?
Well, I think I touched on that sort of in that last little segment there. Yeah. I think, you know, the foundation's work is going to be more important than ever, and I think the challenges are going to be greater. You know, it really is going to take the best effort of the leadership and of leadership within this region to keep this thing working and meeting needs. But again, its importance, I think, will only increase. And I'm tremendously happy that it's there, that it's successful, that we're still a part of it, and look forward to being engaged going forward.
Very good. Good interview.
Thank you.
Camera on.
Okay.
I'm going to do a clap to get a soundtrack spike. I have to sync the two.
Okay.
Okay. Talk to me about your involvement in the St. Croix Valley Foundation. When did it start? Your history with the organization.
Okay. Let's wait until he's done here.
Okay.
He's probably making dinner. No. Nothing good in the fridge.
All right.
So I've been on the board almost 9 years now, and had the privilege of being the chair of the board for a couple of years, and it's just been a great experience.
When did you start with your involvement in the foundation?
I started about 9 years ago. I was invited by Gretchen Stein, who is the current chair of the board, and I was asked to serve and did so joyfully.
One thing that's been interesting to me is that when people were putting together this idea of putting together a sum of money to do some good things, one of the things they considered is just going with an existing foundation and having a little place in that foundation. They talked to some foundations. Why was it important to set up a distinct foundation in the Valley? Oh yeah, by the way, my questions, I'm not going to be in it, so when you answer, if you just give me a yes or no, it won't be very interesting.
Right, I have to do complete sentences.
Yeah.
The original founders looked at the option of just joining another foundation, like one of the great foundations that there are in the Twin Cities, but they felt that the needs of this region were unique. So the founders wanted to make sure that the resources that we had in the Valley stayed in the Valley. And so that's why they started the St. Croix Valley Foundation, with that regional identity.
Was the Valley a kind of a fertile territory in terms of potential donors?
There are really compassionate people who live in the Valley who care so much about it that it was a great place to start a community foundation.
How about wealth in the Valley?
Yeah. There has always been a lot of wealth in the Valley. This is a lumbering community in Stillwater, one of the first communities in Minnesota. And so there was a concentration of wealth. The foundation has also, though, always wanted to make sure that everyone can be a philanthropist. So even though there was a lot of money in the Valley, they wanted to create a vehicle where everyone could leave a legacy.
You weren't present at creation, but have you seen an alteration in the goals of the foundation in your decade of involvement in it?
I was just reading one of their original brochures, and it's amazing that the integrity of the founder's original vision is still there. You can read it in the choice of the words, in the goals that are expressed. I don't think a lot has changed. We have changed the way we have responded to needs, because the needs of the Valley have changed and the opportunities. And so that has changed. But the original intent to create a vehicle where people could leave a legacy has not changed.
Well, talk to me about those changes in the Valley that have changed some of your patterns of giving.
The patterns of giving have stayed pretty much the same in terms of we create a way where people who are passionate about a particular issue or concern or idea can leave money in perpetuity. The giving that we do, though, the charitable giving, has followed the needs of the community. For instance, we have a health and wellness fund now that is working on helping people with childhood obesity, with Alzheimer's, both two issues that may have been present, but not to the degree that they are today.
How do you rate the foundation's ability to get the right people around the table when it comes to solving problems?
One of the really fun parts about being a board member of the St. Croix Valley Foundation is the people that I've had the chance to meet. The foundation is neutral. We check our politics and our religion and our personal beliefs at the door. And we've always had a very neutral stance towards all of that in the Valley. And that's created a safe place for people to convene. So that role of being a convener is really important to us. And so we have programs like Conversations of the Valley that bring probably 120 to 150 people together monthly to explore sometimes controversial issues in the Valley. We also have taken on some pretty big projects to convene people who are, I'm going to start that one over again. We've also taken on some pretty big projects over the years that help us address needs in a safe and neutral way and bring together really good thinkers and compassionate people who want to make a difference.
Have you been in your decade, I know I've talked to other people that have been on the board and some of the founders, and some of them are, I would say, actually quite surprised at how successful the foundation has been at putting together a nice corpus of money.
I really loved listening to the stories from the early founders, because they talk about putting together all of their, almost like pocket change, their church donations, all of the money that they would normally donate to a cause. They put it all together in those early years. And it was a struggle to get to that first $100,000 of assets. And for us now to be at the level of over $40 million in assets in just 20 years is pretty surprising to everyone, I think.
From what I understand, of course, the Great Recession was pretty tough on all organizations, especially nonprofits. But my impression from talking to folks is that you guys did a pretty good job of managing your way through that.
The Great Recession was tough. We, for the first time in the organization's history, we had to dig deep into our resources to be able to honor the commitments that we made, which meant in what's called invading principle. So that meant that we had to go into the block of money that we had set aside, and law allows us to do that. But that was tough. I was on the board at the time, and it was really hard to think about doing that. We hate doing that. That money is there forever, and we don't want to touch it. What was really fascinating to me is our volunteer crackerjack investment people were able to help us weather that storm. In fact, all of us were saying, hey, can't you manage my assets? Because they got us through that. It was extraordinary, really, that they were able to show a return on investment during those years. Not as much as we always have enjoyed, but they made it.
That's amazing. Was the board ultimately pretty much united about dipping into the basic corpus of money, or was it controversial, or how did that play out?
I'll take a drink here, a second. We were caught between two competing values, and both values are really strong. One value on one hand says we preserve these assets forever. The other value says we honor commitments we've made. So people had already requested grants from us to support their work, and we had gone through our grant panels and selected the best ones and awarded those grants. So now it comes time to pay the grants, and we don't have the return on investment that we need to honor all of the commitments. And so that was a tough choice. And we decided, we banked on our ability to recover and to repay and refresh those funds, and chose to go ahead and honor the commitments that we had. And the gamble paid off, because we were able to do that. Those funds are all well beyond where they were at the time, and we were able to serve the needs of people.
So Marty, if you were to fast forward 20 years, mm-hmm. what would you envision this foundation looking like?
Whoa, 20 years from now, where will we be? We'll have significantly more assets. Hopefully we'll have more of those assets under our control, which means that we will be able to grant many more funds out to organizations that need them. We're only meeting a portion of the needs that come to us every year, and it breaks our heart to say no to people when we know that their causes are worthy. So we want to be able to have many more dollars that we can give out. I can see us at some point having a permanent home where we're able to incubate nonprofits, bring them along under our wing. We do that already, but it's not a place. We don't have a place. We provide that support and that nurturing for new nonprofits, but to have a place where they could actually be, people could be and share ideas and resources would be really exciting. I think that's all within our grasp. 20 years, we're going to see a lot of changes in 20 years. The Community Foundation is going to be at the heart of those changes, and I see a really bright future for the foundation.
Some people hazard a guess on what the corpus of money would be in 20 years.
Oh, they hazarded a guess, huh?
Yeah.
20 years from now. What do you think? 500,000?
Million.
Ah, what do you think? 500 million?
Could well be.
What are the ranges of guesses that people have had?
I have to look, because I've had a little bit of a gap, because my mother got sick. And
oh,
I
I'm sorry.
So I've been kind of off this for about a month, but so I'd have to look. But and not, I haven't asked everybody the question, but you may be viewed as a sage in 20 years.
Wouldn't that be fun?
Yeah.
It'd be fun to be a sage in 20 years and be at $500 million.
That's right.
I don't know. It's a guess. The economy makes a big difference for all of us, of course.
Yeah, that's true. Challenges. What do you think the big challenges are going forward?
Let me just think about that for a moment. Okay, I think one of our biggest challenges as we move forward, 20 years is going to encompass a new generation. So the generation of givers that we have right now will be a different generation in 20 years. And I know that this generation is different, they have different priorities, so I think a challenge will be to engage them in philanthropy, engage them in the sense of place. They are much more global than the generation that will pass. And they, the idea of them investing in the St. Croix Valley Community Foundation, the idea of them investing in the St. Croix Valley Foundation may be, I'm going to start that one over again. So I think this is
it's
this,
a good thought,
I think
it's
key.
I hadn't thought about, but I think that's really important.
Okay, so I'm going to do another run at this whole idea.
Yeah, but you're on to something.
I think so. One of the biggest challenges that we're going to have is to take this next generation of givers and challenge them with the commitment to support the St. Croix Valley Foundation and the communities of that are in this region. That generation is different than the generation that will pass in the next 20 years. They have different priorities. They are more global thinking. They see the needs of this great big planet, and to get them to focus and contribute their funds locally like their parents may be a challenge.
You know, it's dangerous to attribute characteristics to any group, but if you think about the greatest generation, who my generation was quite critical of in the 1960s, they look awfully good right now. They had these, they pulled together to do big things.
Mm-hmm.
The war, they lived through a depression.
Mm-hmm.
They had this, they invested in education, they paid their taxes without whining too much. So I wonder if, you know, I think you've really kind of, it's a question mark. What'll be the values of, I mean, different generations probably have different values and different outlooks on things.
Mm-hmm. What is really encouraging to me is that we have younger people on our board now, and they are every bit as committed and passionate and dedicated to this region as anyone else on the board. And they have new and fresh ideas. So I think that the future is going to be in very, very good hands with this younger group of people. But we have to recruit them. We have to get them engaged in the board now. And they're like us at that age, they're very busy people. They've got careers, they've got families, they've got homes. So to encourage them to serve on the board, to encourage them to think about philanthropy, they have a lot of competing interests.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. So now, of all the activities that the foundation engages in so many different areas, from your own standpoint, after being involved 10 years, what are a couple areas that will give you the greatest satisfaction, where you've seen the greatest results?
One that I have, okay, I have to start that one over because one doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
One of our greatest accomplishments in my tenure as a board member, I think, is seeking to get this whole area chosen as a The National Heritage Area initiative that we took on and were involved in for about 5 years is probably one of my areas of greatest pride. I had the ability to be chair of the task force during that time when we decided that this area indeed has national significance and we should start to identify all of the historical and cultural, environmental and artistic assets that we have in the whole watershed. This was a really big idea for the St. Croix Valley Foundation, which seems pretty limited and narrow. Valley is narrow. This is, watershed is wide, 8,000 square miles. And again, as a neutral convener, we thought it would be a good place for us to be, not to make decisions, but to bring together people who can share their stories and their passions about the region.
Yeah, I've been tracking that a little bit out of my involvement with the St. Croix River Association.
Mm-hmm.
They're very interested in that too.
Yeah, the St. Croix River Association's has had a representative at the tables from the beginning, and yeah, it's a great project. Still going. We're playing down the national part of it right now because that's become a political football, but we don't even care. Ultimately, it should be a national heritage area, but it's a heritage area. And so we're acting now like a heritage area and starting to pull together and mobilize all the assets that we have. So stay tuned on that one. There'll be a lot more coming.
All right. Is there anything else that you want to mention?
A lot of people will point to the Partners for the Future work that we did as one of the most successful things that the foundation ever did. And I can't argue with that. It was amazing. We provided matching funds to, I think it was like 18 nonprofits who started capital campaigns, and we supported them through nonprofit leadership conferences and training through a partnership with St. Thomas and helped develop their skills and their capacity. And every single one of those nonprofits were able to meet their endowment goals. And we'd like to do that again. It was supported by a generous gift from the Bremer Foundation. And so we hope that someday we'll be able to pull that one off again because it was really successful.
I guess the last question I have, then I'm going to ask you if there's any questions you think I should have asked. What qualities have you observed, or if you think about it, were evident in the people that put this together 20 years ago that, you know, what is it that causes people to do good and public-oriented things like this? What do you know from people you know from that era?
I would love to have a conversation. Seriously, I'd love to have a conversation with you because that question. The question of why does someone do this kind of work is absolutely intriguing to me. People have so many places that they can invest their time and money and their talents. Why this one? Greater than that, why do people give back at all? Because there are a lot of people who don't. Somehow this group of people decided to take a really big risk. They're amazing people. We had a reunion of our founders, and the energy in that room was incredible. I have people who were just so, you can edit this out. The early founders were risk takers, and they really believed in making a long-term difference. It's a hard concept. The people that have the most trouble understanding about a foundation will ask a question like, "But why should I give the money to you and then have just a small part of it return to a nonprofit? Why don't I just give the money to the nonprofit?" And it's a hard concept to say, if you give the money to us, that money will multiply over the years and help that nonprofit forever, instead of for just right now. So it's that difference between long-term vision and short-term immediate vision. And our founders had that long-term vision.
They must feel a certain pride after 20 years and seeing what the seed, little seed they planted, what it turned into.
Absolutely. John Baird talked about that someday this tiny stream would become a mighty river. And we quote that, we quote John a lot with that whole idea. It's a perfect analogy for us with the St. Croix River, of course, flowing through our region. But our founders are very proud of where we've come.
Good reason. So is there anything else you think that I've overlooked that I should ask?
This is fun. what else should you have asked? Let me see. Let me drag this out, this fun, longer. I don't know. I can't think of anything.
Well, then I got a question. Has this group of people on this foundation, it appears, since you've been successful, must have also done a good job of selecting staff over the years.
We haven't had a lot of staff. We've had 3 executive directors. I don't know if that's true. It's been 3. I'll start it over.
Yeah.
So our staff is very small, and we haven't had a lot of executive directors. They've all been amazing. Gretchen Stein likes to talk about the right people at the right time, and that's been true of our presidents. They have been exactly the right people at the right time. Their talents and abilities have been different. Their personalities have been different. They've been exactly right when they served. And that's really been true of our board chairs and our board members. We've been really fortunate to have the right people at the right time serving the foundation. Not without controversy. There have been many times when we have disagreed, heartily disagreed, about a direction to take. And we govern much by consensus. So when we come to an agreement, we support each other. And it's been absolutely the best board experience I've ever had. I love this board. I love the foundation. I love what it stands for.
That's great. Well,
have you talked about the decision to go with community foundations? Has that come up?
Why don't you talk about that? I'd like your take on it.
A few years ago, we came up with a different strategy. We actually changed our name. I trip over it sometimes. I say the St. Croix Valley Community Foundation. We changed our name to the St. Croix Valley Foundation. And what that reflected was a change in the way in which we decided to go about developing the resources in the valley. And that was to start community foundations or embrace community foundations that were already in existence and nurture them, grow those foundations. We felt that people would give more if it was in their own community. So we now have 11 community foundations under our umbrella, and we learn from them every day. They learn from each other, and together we have a much deeper relationship with the community than we could ever have with just the overall foundation board. So we have all of these communities that are doing amazing things like community vision, envisioning and community development projects, educational programs, as well as their own grants programs and their own reaching out to citizens who then can give back in their own communities. So that was a change in strategy that was intentional, and it was an important change for us and a good one.
Very good. And what you said about...
All right, first question is, what did you see back in 1995 that needed to be done in terms of your motivation to create the foundation?
Okay. We weren't on the board at that time. Okay.
Okay.
But I can speak to that.
Okay.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can talk about community.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think when this idea originally came up, a number of citizens in the community were actually polled in terms of their attitude towards the idea of a community foundation. I happened to be superintendent of schools at that time and had some strong beliefs that as you took a look at the really good school districts in our region, backing and behind those school districts were strong communities. So the idea of a community foundation being created to strengthen the community had a strong appeal to me in terms of the potential benefit that it could lead to for the school district. I could just see the combination, strong communities, strong schools, community foundation, all sort of resonating together.
In 1995, we both were serving on the United Way board here in Stillwater. And there was a lot of discussion about reaching out to the communities across the St. Croix River. And is the river a barrier or is it a bond? And there was an effort launched at that time to collaborate more with the United Ways on both sides of the river to advance services for people and to build philanthropy. And the United Ways, of course, raise money in a year and then allocate it within that year. And there seemed to be a real need to build a more lasting way of financing the needs of people in the community as well as building philanthropy at that time.
John Baird told me that they didn't want it, even though most of the early proponents for this were from the Stillwater area, they didn't want it to be just a Stillwater Foundation, so there was an effort to go beyond the borders of Minnesota. Wait until that goes by, whatever it is. Okay, so what was the strategy starting this foundation, you know, across the border, actually, the headquarters?
Mm-hmm. I think the people in Stillwater, the leaders, the visionaries, really felt that if we wanted to make this a whole St. Croix Valley effort. We needed to have a presence in Wisconsin and not make it look like it was a Stillwater thing for Stillwater people. And so they made a great effort to reach out. I believe the first office was actually in Somerset, Wisconsin, before now it's in Hudson, to include the community, what we called the community of communities, because at that time there really wasn't this identity. It was a vision that there would be an identity as of the St. Croix Valley and the community of the valley. It was more a community of communities. New Richmond stood alone, Hudson stood alone, Stillwater stood alone, and there was this vision, which I greatly applaud with those first founders of the foundation, that let's embrace the entire valley and make this one community, because people were coming to Stillwater for services in the nonprofits. The nonprofits were delivering service across the river, and it seemed that the time was right for there to be a more collaboration and to branch out. And the effort was made, let's start then in Wisconsin so we don't look so Stillwater focused.
You know, that just occurred to me as I have been reflecting on this in the past, that there were a lot of skeptics at the time that thought the river is going to be a barrier. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting to me as I look back at it, a good example at the time of where that barrier was broken down was with the Boy Scouts. And there were a number of people who were among the original founders who had been active in support of the Boy Scout organization. And the Boy Scout organization at that time was a good example of something in effect in the valley that had bridged that barrier, because the actual district at that time for this area comprised communities in western Wisconsin as they did in the communities on the eastern side of the river.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Was there a kind of a sense that there was sufficient wealth in the valley to make a foundation work?
Yes, definitely. And one of the things that the early founders realized was that a lot of the people with money in the valley were actually placing their money in the Twin Cities, in either the St. Paul or the Minneapolis foundations. And it seemed that we were losing an opportunity to build philanthropy here and to keep it here so that it could serve the people in the valley, as well as the donors who wanted to give back to the valley, to the place they love. So I could see a great opportunity, and we still do. I mean, obviously it grew from very little to a good amount of assets today in the multi-millions. I think it's, do you know? Over $40 million currently in assets, maybe even more than that today. It depends on the stock market. So from a very small little seed amount of money, it grew very quickly. So yes, I think so.
Wasn't there some talk originally about even establishing a fund within an established fund in the Twin Cities?
I think there was. Gretchen and I were not part of that originally founding group, so I can only speak from a general understanding that the original founders did look at the different possibilities. And being part of the larger foundation, the St. Paul Foundation, the Minneapolis Foundation, or I think things considered at the time, but the decision was to go with our own St. Croix Valley Foundation was the best of the deals.
Mm-hmm. How long have the two of you been involved with the foundation? Since when?
I came on the board in 2004 and stayed for three-year terms. And now we're still working as past chairs on the Board Affairs Committee. So,
I came on a couple of years later than that and served most of three terms.
Yes.
And both Gretchen and I had the fortune of being president of the foundation at
board chair
at one time, and as she already indicated, we still are playing a small role.
Mm-hmm. So in the time you were there, Gretchen, that's 2004, that's 11 years, there's probably been, talk about the growth in the funds.
Oh, yes. Well, when I came in, it was just at the time that the founding board was rotating off. They'd met their commitment to three-year terms, and so it was a time of great transition. And at that time, we were under $10 million, and it was a few years later that we hit the $10 million mark. So it took that many years to get to $10 million, and then it's really grown exponentially since then. So that was pretty exciting back then.
I have a little different story to tell because...
I know your story.
I came on board, I became chair of the foundation when the recession hit. And that has its own story because foundations throughout the country were starting to experience problems, and our foundation was no different than any of the rest, with, I think, one exception, is that our board of directors at the time, when things started to plateau out a little bit, they never lost their dream. They never lost what I'd call this vision of being a large community-based foundation, and never let up on wanting to move through the problem. In fact, we had to laugh, Gretchen and I, when we were reflecting on this. We started the gray envelope. We started the gray envelope tradition where, as chair, I had an opportunity to introduce it and explain to the board members, well, now we're all going to have to make some kind of financial contribution in order to make sure that we can keep this thing going and we still have some income coming in.
To cover operations.
Yeah, yeah. Basically to cover operations at the time. So it's, as I reflect back on this, it was a wonderful experience to see us not only hold our own as we went through this recession, but certainly as things started to pick up, then the foundation's assets started to grow dramatically.
And that those first visionary board members often talk about the fact that in the beginning, to get some assets into the foundation, they were putting their church donations through the foundations. They were putting everything they were donating was going through the foundation so that it would boost the amount of money and the amount of giving. And the board's commitment continues to this day, 20 years later, that all board members still are very supportive of the organization too.
Gretchen did, her comments just reminded me of something else that was really critical. In terms of those original founders who had donated the money in the first place to get the foundation going, a number of them, at our request, came back during the time of this recession to make additional significant contributions, like they did when the original organization was founded.
Now that car is a problem. Could you repeat what you just said at the end, because I can splice it together about some of the original folks coming back again?
Okay, Gretchen's comment just reminded me of something else that I think would be significant to note. It was during this time of the recession that our board went back to a number of the original founders and asked them if they would make an additional significant contribution in order to help us weather the storm we were going through. And we're really grateful that a number of them stepped forth with actually a couple of them with equal to the original donation.
So would you say there was kind of a thought that we should keep money in the valley in the valley to sponsor programs here?
Yes, definitely. There's been a number of initiatives to build philanthropy in the valley and also to build the management of the nonprofit organizations that are here to make them stronger so that they can deliver the mission that a donor might be interested in. In 2004, there was the Community Partnership Initiative, which actually brought money to help nonprofits learn more about good management practices. And there are a number of very small nonprofits. There's some good-sized ones here in the Valley. But some of those were, they really benefited from helping their boards and their staff management to build a stronger nonprofit network for services. And then in 2006, there was the community partnership, I can't remember the full name of it now, Partners for the Future, that's it.
Partners for the Future.
And Partners for the Future actually was a matching grant of $1 million that started to build the endowments for those nonprofits that were part of that partnership. And there was a lot of education also given at that time to their boards on how to raise money and the value of an endowment to support their mission going forward. So there was a lot of work, and there is, continues today, a lot of work that the foundation does to support.
One part of this that I think gets lost in the discussion specifically about the foundation and just keeping money in the Valley is the commitment that the foundation has made in general to educate people on the importance of philanthropy, regardless of where they spend, regardless of what they put, where they put their money. Mm-hmm. So I've always thought that was one of the most important things we do, and that is to educate the community. And people may be sitting out there with sums of money that they're wondering what they can do with it. Educate them on the importance of philanthropy, how it works, avenues available to them where they can contribute money, and through that, obviously, much of that's going to go to the nonprofits in this region. But the important thing is just impressing about how our communities need to thrive and survive on the basis of philanthropy.
I'm going to pause just a second here. Particular programs that pleased you in terms of the results?
Okay, I have two that come to mind, and their field of interest programs for the foundation. One is the Management Assistance Grant Program, and that gives money to nonprofits to help them build their infrastructure. And I've sat on that granting committee, and it's very interesting to see the needs of the wide variety of nonprofits that are in the Valley, and how some money to help with strategic planning or other initiatives really can help that organization serve many, many people. I also sat on the grant committee for the health and wellness program and on that granting program, and that was focused on childhood obesity in the Valley, and it was really interesting to first of all see their grant requests and then to see what was done with the money in a very innovative way of helping children learn about nutrition and exercise and fun ways to get out in nature and connect to the beautiful St. Croix Valley and live healthier lives.
One area that comes immediately to mind is the gifting and granting that has been done to various school organizations throughout the Valley to support and encourage their music programs, music education performance programs. That'd be the type of thing that I would be thinking about.
Yeah, I love that program too. I remember there was like a request for a tuba in a band in western Wisconsin that could not afford a tuba, but now they have a tuba and it makes a big difference for their marching band in their school and just the many children whose lives have been touched by music who may never have been able to afford an instrument or to have had a visiting musician come in and talk to them it's life changing.
That one is touching to me too. That's very, yeah. Very nice. So looking forward, first of all, the assets, Jane told me a couple of days ago, were $46
million. Thank you.
Yeah, and to start out 20 years ago and get there is pretty impressive. So as you think forward now,
yes.
if you're looking ahead another 20 years, what would be your vision for the St. Croix Valley Foundation? Wait until that noise is gone. Okay.
My vision for the St. Croix Valley Foundation, actually working back through the affiliates, I'm very optimistic in terms of the growth in terms of assets of the foundation. I don't know that I have a specific target in mind, but I can envision what in the next 20 years. I don't see any problem in being $200 million in assets. I think the way it is going, and with the support of the affiliates, and they're reaching out into their communities, I think the assets will grow significantly during this period of time.
I'm really excited for what has happened so far and what's going to happen, that I would never have imagined when I started with the foundation that we would have been able to link all of these communities together. There's over 10 affiliates now going all the way up to Burnett County, and we feel linked because we have this identity called the St. Croix Valley. And that's so exciting that people are connecting and have an identity and look to the St. Croix Valley Foundation to help them grow their communities and philanthropy in their communities and meet the needs of the citizens in their communities. And then we see ourselves as having this identity as well. And I think as time goes on, those of us who are here and now know the work of the foundation will have passed. And our legacies will continue because we gave now for the future. And you know, there's people there, and we know eventually they're in their wills that there'll be gifts, and I like to know that that's going to be true for us.
Well said.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, are there, you know, when something succeeds like this, were there particular people that played a bigger role than others in creating it or moving it along at a certain point?
Yes. Those visionaries, and I made the point of when I was board chair, because I was in that transitional time of bringing them back so the new board members could see the vision and continue the vision. And so it's Jim Bradshaw and Dave Brad. I'm going to not tell them all, but there's so many, the founding board, and someone should actually list the names of the founding board, because those people had a vision for what this could be when it was nothing. It was a blank canvas, and now it's become a masterpiece. And it's Sarah Anderson, David Brandt, Jim Bradshaw, I think John Coughlin was involved.
Orv Johnson.
Orv Johnson, yes. J.C. Pfeiffer, Marilyn McCarty over in New Richmond, Molly Gilwyrick, who's a judge up in Polk County. I think Heidi Aspern was also from Amory and part of the group that was that first founding board, and I know I've left some out.
I think credit also needs to be given to the executive directors that that were all part of the building process. The original executives and then when Jane Stevenson came on the board, actually during your was hired during your tenure.
Yes.
Jane came to the board with significant community foundation experience and really helped build on the good work of the previous executives by developing that sense of community and what a community foundation should really look like if it's going to be successful. And it took this original dream, I think, of the founders took it over a period of time and has provided real excellent leadership to subsequent boards entertaining that dream.
Yes, and the executives have been Ron Cruz was the original, and then Linda Jacobson came in as interim, and then followed by David Griffith, who was there when I started with the foundation, and then as David mentioned, Jane Stevenson has just been also an excellent president for our foundation. We've been really blessed with great staff. Truly.
So Dave, so you ended up having the good fortune to chair the board at a time of great economic stress, kind of like taking over the Confederate Army on the steps of the Appomattox there. So was that a really stressful time?
It was stressful, but not as much as you would think, because the board was really dedicated to weathering this problem. Chris Galvin was the treasurer in charge of the finance committee at the time. Recently he's retired from that position, but Chris, with his background at the Anderson Corporation and just a brilliant thinker in terms of how finances needed to work. And I worked with him and sort of doing some graphs and projections as to where we were lagging behind and where we needed to catch up. And it was actually stressful, but there was a lot of fun at the same time because we had a definite plan for how we were going to work ourselves back up to a strong asset position.
And David would never say this, but his leadership and his reputation in this community, I think, did a lot at the time when people's needs were increasing so much, but the economy was taking a nosedive, and of course our assets were going down. And people have confidence, they truly do have confidence in David and his leadership, and I think part of who we also had as a board chair made a big difference during those times. He would never say that.
So how do you decide to deploy your money? I mean, so you, when that recession hit, were you well positioned? Did you take less of a hit, about the same amount of hit, or a greater hit than? How did you anticipate the recession in terms of the deployment of your assets?
Well, I'd have to go back and give a significant amount of credit to Chris Galvin. We were working with area financial organizations, and like I say, we actually did have a plan based on what we considered was the best thinking at the time in terms of what the recovery was going to look like. And we felt if we could just, you know, hold on for this period of time and get our ducks in a row so that when we broke out of the recession, things would be better. And I think those plans worked. I can't remember right now exactly the specifics, but I do know that we spent a lot of time thinking about not only how we're going to weather the storm, but what position we needed to be in when things started improving so we could start to really build our asset base back again.
Most foundations have a focus or, you know, they have several areas they work in. What would you describe as the focus of the St. Croix Valley Foundation?
Well, I think I think the focus of the St. Croix Valley Foundation in my mind has been on building community through philanthropy, and it's tried to take a sort of a broad look at philanthropy to be able to attract a variety of different interests in terms of donors, but it hasn't been so broad that it doesn't have focus to it as well. It's been definitely designed to build communities that reflect the interests of the citizens in this part of the region.
What would you say are the, going forward, are the some of the pressing needs and areas meriting some attention going for word. Okay, I think it's correct. Yeah.
Well, I know there's a real need to build the field of interest in the health and wellness area. There are a lot of people that still need help, and our lifestyle is not necessarily the healthiest. And so I think that's an area that the foundation definitely wants to build in.
I think the demographics of the region are changing somewhat. And I think with the opening of the new bridge, the population that's expected in western Wisconsin, the increase in population that's expected, I think will be raising some challenges for different communities in terms of the populations they serve and the needs that those populations may bring. So I see it as a very dynamic environment out here in the valley, and it's changing. And I think through the work of the affiliates that you have in place, I have a lot of confidence that they're going to be really on top of what's needed within their communities, that the needs that are going to be changing over the next years of what I see as a changing demographics.
And there's a couple of balancing acts I'm thinking of too. One is the haves, the people who have wealth, and the people who don't. And though I have not heard a large conversation about that, there is this gap with people who really need help. And I think the Community Foundation, being based in with the affiliate networks in each community, offers an opportunity, as David expressed, for each community to look at their community and what do we need most here, with that balancing act with the people who have wealth and the people who are just struggling to get by. And then there's also the balancing act with the environment itself, maintaining and having a healthy environment, as well as the growth in this area. So that balance and creating sustainability and health and all of that is an important piece that I know the foundation is also interested and concerned about.
I guess my last question would be one which will be interesting in history. I'll ask each of you to kind of, why don't you set a goal for where the foundation should be in 20 years? And then when people are looking back on it in 20 years, they will see how close you are.
You mean financial goal?
Yeah, financial goal. So go ahead.
I see like 200 million. I don't see a problem with that as this area grows. And if you would have asked me 20 years ago when we're less than a million, I would have said, do you think we really are going to be at 46 million 20 years from now? So I think as you watch money grow and grow, and people be more interested in this, and also the word of the St. Croix Valley Foundation, so people even know about us, spreads, I don't think it's that's such a huge dream. I think it's a great possibility.
Well, I think I've used the figure 200 million before myself, and I think part of it is my assumption is that the population is going to grow out in this area somewhat as well. I think there's going to be potentially more donors out here that have convinced that philanthropy is a good thing, that there's going to be some additional resources out here as well.
Mm-hmm. That does give rise to another question I have, which is the reason you're successful is that you found more and more people who have some wealth who want to be a part of this. How do you get the word out?
Well, I think a lot of what has happened and will have to continue to happen is people reaching out to people. I've been involved in fundraising of a variety of kind throughout my life, and I still find that the most effective way of attracting potential donors are people who are currently donating, who currently believe in the cause, and who are reaching out to other people who they think may be interested in the same thing. So I think marketing is important and all of that kind of thing. But I still think one of the keys will be to continue to attract to the foundation board, to the affiliate boards, those people who have a real interest in philanthropy, have a real interest in community, and can reach out to other people and convince them that they need to join them in this partnership.
And the other part of the growth has come from bringing in organizations that had endowment funds on their own and bring it in under the management of the St. Croix Valley Foundation, because the financial track record has been so good with the foundation and the way they invest that it makes sense for FIPS and the other organizations out there to come in. Family Means is another example, to come in under the St. Croix Valley Foundation's management, where the decisions are still made at the board level for those organizations, but their money is well managed and they don't have to spend their assets managing independently their money. So that's been one of the wonderful things about a community foundation. It can do that for so many in the community as well. And that's been part of the growth too.
Very good.
I have two questions I would answer.
I was going to ask you that. What didn't I ask that you want to answer?
Well, one of the things I remembered when you'd asked David about how did we weather that 2008 downturn, and I know that our foundation, compared to other community foundations in the country, we were like the top 14. I think we were number 14 in the foundations that weathered that. So we were way above average in maintaining our assets during that time.
I was just thinking that when you were talking about that, because I think, in fact, I'm going to use a figure. I think our foundation, during most of that period of time, we were still generating 8% on our assets.
Yes.
While foundations throughout the country and other organizations, some of them were losing money, but certainly not generating anywhere near close to what our financial plan was drawing in at the time.
Wow. And then the other project I would have talked about, that I thought a little more about it, was the Heritage Foundation, the Congressional Heritage, Congressional Heritage Designation Project that they worked on. Congressional Heritage Designation Project, and that was to talk to people in the valley, to bring groups of people together all the way, again, from Grantsburg to down in Prescott, that whole group of folks together to talk about, could this become a congressional heritage area? And that brought us people together. It brought the St. Croix Valley out, the St. Croix Valley Foundation out, so people had some recognition of who we were. It was a collaborative effort. It was an effort to bring us together to discuss things that were going on, and why would we be unique? Why would people come here? Why should Congress say that we're a special area? And the stories that came out of the early settlers, the European Americans, the Native Americans who were here, stories of why this is special to families, why this is special to different cultural groups. It brought that, it did what the vision had been, which is to bring us all together and think of ourselves as one community under a label of the St. Croix Valley. So it did some wonderful things, that Heritage Initiative, that I'm really proud of.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Well, very good.
Is there anything else you thought of?
No, that's good.
All right, so that's running.
Good.
So I'd like to start out just tell us who you are and what you do, just to kind of relax a little bit.
Good. My name is Steve Schrader. I'm a board member of the St. Croix Valley Foundation. My day job is being a consulting actuary for defined benefit pension plans run by corporations, run by municipalities, and quite frankly, getting too expensive. So my job today is tearing down what I used to set up. That's what I do.
So describe how long you've been involved in the St. Croix Valley Foundation.
Good. My tenure at the foundation is now about 4 years as a board member. Prior to that, for 6 years, I served on the Foundation of River Falls board. And 9 years prior to that, I was a board member of the Hudson Community Foundation. So you can add all of those up if you want. It's been very good for my participation on the St. Croix Valley Foundation because of being with one of our, two of our affiliate foundation boards.
So when you say affiliate, describe what that means.
We have 10 foundations that we consider affiliates. They are not 501c3 organizations, so a contribution directly to an affiliate is not a tax-deductible event. We provide that tax deductibility. We also, with our staff, provide full-time administrative services to every one of those affiliates. Not just collecting money, not just granting money, but all of the various administrative things that must be done, filing report 990, keeping things up to speed. The affiliates are smaller and they can't afford that type of administrative talent.
So what kind of coordinating goes on between the St. Croix Valley Foundation and these affiliates in terms of yearly goals or aims or direction?
Well, to start out with, Margie Miller at the foundation attends many of the affiliate meetings and provides professional guidance from that standpoint. Annually, as I mentioned, there must be proper reporting to the Internal Revenue Service that we accomplish for the affiliates. But from my standpoint, having served on two of those affiliate boards, having that expertise join us from time to time really helped out in our planning, in our trying to raise funds, and all of the things that we were trying to do without professional staff, and all of us were volunteers not knowing really what was going on. A great, great provider of service from the St. Croix Valley Foundation to the affiliates.
Usually foundations have a focus, and so do you coordinate focuses or do you communicate with one another so you can cover the waterfront better? How does that all work?
The focus idea is something that we're really concentrating on today, providing the St. Croix Valley from a water standpoint, from a land usage standpoint, from a arts, from an education, all of the various scholarships that some of the affiliates are very, very interested in. We work with them on the best way to handle that type of focus or to get them a little more focused rather than trying to cover the waterfront.
So what need do you see in the valley that could be addressed by this foundation at this point?
From a need standpoint, number one, the affiliates and the foundation, the St. Croix Valley Foundation, need to work better together in focusing on particular needs in particular geographies. Some of our affiliates are not on the river, so to speak. They have rather different needs than those that are sitting on the river. Some of them are much more involved in the arts than others. Those types of needs, especially locally as relates to children, as relates to homeless, as relates to some of the better uses of money. There's too much homelessness, there's too much trouble in terms of providing services for sexual assault, for the different problems that we have in our society. I remember coming on the River Falls board, people saying, well, that doesn't happen in Lily White River Falls, and of course it does. We have, for example, 82 children this year in our school district who are homeless. And that's incredible when we think of River Falls, Wisconsin. The foundation can provide all sorts of support to that situation.
I thought it was kind of interesting in talking to some of the other interviewees that when people were thinking about putting this foundation together, the first thing they did is they went and talked to some of the more established foundations and were thinking about just having a unit within the foundation and borrowing their 501c status. But they decided in the end to have something in the valley. And that must have something to do with wanting to focus on the valley.
Absolutely. We talked to St. Paul, we talked to Bremer, we talked to the big foundations, and some of them gave our affiliates excellent financial support to get going. We appreciate that very much. But their focus is not in the valley, and that's where we wanted and continue to want our focus to be.
And there also are probably some resources in the valley that a foundation in Minneapolis-St. Paul could not tap. Is that correct?
That is absolutely correct. To be specific, the Anderson Corporation and all of the foundations connected with it, they're valley-oriented, and they have been so generous in providing support, ongoing support, over the 20 years we've been in existence.
And so there are obvious advantages to keeping money local, and we've kind of talked about that. But if you have any other thoughts on that?
The affiliates, because they know the people in their various geographies and we don't, some of those people insist on keeping the money local, and we provide that support. I don't want to deviate from that. I don't want any kind of conflict with everyone thinking that the St. Croix Valley Foundation knows more or does a better job. Not at all. It's our help, our assistance to the local affiliates in keeping that money local.
So do you, given your long involvement in this foundation work, have you seen a shift in goals or orientation for this foundation and the others you've been involved in?
Again, with the, I hate to say it this way, with the increasing needs, basic needs, yes, there's a shift. We try to emphasize the arts. We try to emphasize those finer areas that we have been involved in, and I don't mean finer that way. But again, with homelessness, with sexual assault, with the various basic problems, we need to pay attention to that shift in our society, because we have less and less money coming from the state and the federal government to support that.
Sometimes addressing a serious problem requires getting the right people around the table. How would you describe the foundation's success at doing that?
Good for you. The success we've had is identifying talent. Obviously, people who want to work with us, but we need investors. We need investment talent. We need financial talent. We need arts. We need various segments. We're now looking to replace our medical member, and we want someone from the medical profession. That kind of divergence, diversity is very, very important to us.
Are you surprised at the success that this foundation has had in 20 years at putting together a corpus of money?
I am not. I am not surprised that we've done a really quite an outstanding job because of the talents of the founders, of the commitment of the people who are sitting on the board in gathering money, in soliciting the ideas of, and promoting the ideas of philanthropy. Right now we're involved in a tremendous project as relates to something near and dear to me. I lost my mother to Alzheimer's, and we, in our Remember project, are going to 40 different presentations in 15 different communities in making people more knowledgeable and trying to help develop dementia-friendly communities. It's just been a marvelous thing. That takes money, and people understand that and relate to that.
You said earlier about you weren't surprised at the success because of the commitment and the capabilities of these board members. There's some people that just like to accumulate money and don't really have much of a commitment to anything but that. And then there are people, I think, like that have got involved in this foundation. What is that impulse? Where does that come from?
quite frankly, in my line of business, the deductibility of the contribution is something that's important to some of my clients slash contributors to this foundation. But I don't mean to be crass at all. That's an important part of financial planning, and so be it. On the other hand, with donor-advised funds, the Internal Revenue Service allows a person to provide us with money, get an immediate tax deduction, and then over the years give us advice as to how that money should be distributed. They can't demand, but we are not about to go a different way than they advise us. And that's a remarkable thing.
It must be a strong element of idealism or some sense of a greater purpose too, though, isn't there?
Absolutely. Philanthropy is a strange thing for me. I didn't grow up in a family or in surroundings that philanthropy was something that we talked about. We didn't tithe to our church. We provided some funds, but it has frankly grown on me knowing people who are committed to it. And it's been a wonderful change in my character, I guess, but to be involved in this and to benefit from that greater idea that you're talking about.
One thing that impressed me in some of my discussions with people involved in this is that the founding fathers, they mostly in the beginning were from the Stillwater area.
Right.
But they didn't want it to be a Stillwater fund. And so they've, ever since the beginning, since creation, they've made an effort to have a foundation that had members from all over the valley, basically. Do you have any thoughts on the wisdom of that?
It has been so wise from the very beginning to spread our membership in the board and to spread our philanthropy throughout the entire valley and not be provincial, although, again, if a River Falls contributor wants the money to stay in River Falls, we obviously pay attention to that. But the broader aspect of this board, as I said, not only maintaining different professional backgrounds, but different geographic backgrounds as well, has been very important. We will continue that.
So, Steve, given your, again, long connection with this activity in the Valley, who do you think the heroes were in the beginning that were responsible for the creation of this?
Yeah. I've had the privilege of sitting with Orv Johnson on a number of occasions. Somebody find me a finer man and a more dedicated person to what this foundation is all about. Again, those types of people that I have met who were the original founders have helped me understand philanthropy much better. Again, it's not something I grew up with. It's not something that was natural for me.
One of the things that John Baird was talking about, I mean, I heard one of his contributions at board meetings was that it's easy to spend the money. Where is the focus on raising the money? But they've done a pretty good job of that.
John Baird, a tremendous, tremendous talent at raising and giving money.
It seems to me this organization fared through the Great Recession better than others. Do you have any insight into that?
The financial acumen of our board really did a great job of taking care of where the money was invested, where the money was spent. We had to tighten our bootstraps just like everybody else did, our belts. It is, and I'll again get specific, that Chris Galvin, as our board member, as our chief financial officer, we call him a treasurer, but he was a chief financial officer, giving us incredible guidance during the recession.
And I understand that even though there, what the recession hit and promises had been made, and this foundation found a way to, you know, they took some risks and made those commitments despite the downturn.
The preponderance of our growth has been through contributions and not through appreciation of assets. You've got to pay attention to both, but during the recession we were able, as contributions slowed down, to take advantage of the I'm going to say brilliant investment that had been occurred, that had been developed for our portfolio.
I wish they would have taken care of my money.
And my 401k suffered badly during the recession.
If you were to project, the St. Croix Valley Foundation has been around 20 years now, and they're up to a little over $40 million. If you were to project ahead, would you risk or hazard a guess as to where, either a guess or would you state where you hope the fund would be in 20 more years?
Yeah, in 20 more years, we'll be well past $100 million. I think we'll be there in 10 years. So at our 30th anniversary, I'd like to see us at $100 million. Through mostly contribution, not taking risk in the market, we have employed an outstanding financial guide out of Cincinnati. They have done a superb job with handling our investments at this point. They give us guidance. We make the decisions in our Finance and Investment Committee. But it is all about contributions and the proper solicitation of people in the Valley.
I've got two more questions that come to mind. One is that there undoubtedly is wealth in this Valley. And the fact that this foundation was situated here must have helped to access that.
There's no question about the wealth in the Valley. The situation, originally we were officed in Somerset, which is kind of unusual, and not that there's anything wrong with Somerset, but let's get to the Valley. So bringing the offices into Hudson was a very good idea. Secondly, paying attention to where that wealth is, corporately and privately, and finding board members who either were part of that wealth or who knew the people who were. This is a matter of relationships, just like any business. We are a business, and we are all about growth, and we are all about giving.
Last question. apparently, you've been blessed from time to time with good staff work, too, to last this long. Any comments about that?
I'm overwhelmed at the professionalism of the staff. To have people who know the business, again, I'm talking about a business here, has benefited us in so many ways. In, again, helping the affiliates get off, getting a good start, helping the affiliates do the right thing, helping us board members do the right thing. The staff is key to us. We are volunteers. I don't know anything about this business as such. We are just blessed with the folks that we have.
Well, Steve, is there any question I didn't ask that you think I should have, or is there anything you'd like to say in conclusion?
I think it's very important that everyone know that we have a board turnover every 9 years. After 9 years, a person leaves the board. We are continually looking for good people to serve on our board, people who know others in the Valley, and we are continually looking at good staff. It's a project. We're always trying to improve, and it's a work in progress from that standpoint.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good. Done good.
suppose I better check it. Everything seemed to be doing quite well here. I'm going to turn the recorder on.
All right.
And I'm going to turn the camera on.